courage. And thank you for your love for our city. It's inspiring. It really is. And so preach for us. Love you. Yes, sir.
There we go. It always helps when you turn it on. Amen. It is an honor to be here today. I'm so grateful to be able to come and preach in this great church that's been a partner and sister church here in the city now for over 20 years, co-laboring together, kind of on opposite ends of the valley. As I got here over 20 years ago, and we just kind of agreed, let's try to meet in the middle. Let's just take Las Vegas for Jesus. But thank you for being a church that lives generously. Brett didn't give me any heads up into the first service that they were going to be presenting that check for church planting, and I want to bring you greetings on behalf of church planters all over North America. Because of your generosity last year through Send Network, we saw 734 new churches started in North America, and we give God praise for that. We currently have about 1,200 church planters in our four-year funding matrix that we are planting all over North America, and they're supported by your giving. Every weekend when you give here at this fellowship, you are investing a portion of that in seeing the church multiplied. And I like to say it like this: Send Network doesn't plant churches. Networks don't plant churches. Denominations don't plant churches. Individuals don't plant churches. Churches plant churches. Living things reproduce themselves. And so as a fellowship, you are leaning in and planting churches. And I want to thank you for your investment in Send Network. Let me lead us in a word of prayer, and then I want to jump into the text today. Father, thank you so much for this sweet fellowship. Thank you for Pastor Brett and his family. Lord, what a friend, what a gospel co-laborer here in the city. God, I'm honored to stand in his pulpit today. And Lord, as we begin to open your word here in just a moment, Father, today we are reminded that the last thing we need is to just go through the motions of another church service. Lord, many people in this room have been to more church services and heard more sermons than some people in the world will in their entire life. But God, we're gathered here today because we do need a fresh encounter with the living God. Lord, I pray today that your Holy Spirit would take your word and speak to your people as only you can. God, I pray that the message and the preaching would not be in persuasive words of wisdom, but a demonstration of your spirit and power, so that the faith of those who hear would not rest on the wisdom of men, but on the power of God. Lord, have your way today. It's in the name of Jesus I pray. Amen. I came across a quote a number of years ago by a man named William James that really marked my life. It's become a quote that I've shared a lot of places that I've been. And here's what he said. I don't remember where I read it. I just remember when I read it, it marked me. Here's what he said: the great use of a life is to spend it for something that outlasts it. The great use of a life is to spend it for something that outlasts it. William James is talking about legacy. He's talking about living a life that's going to outlive you. And when I read it for the first time, when I heard it for the first time, everything in me said, yes, I want my life to matter. I want to live my life in such a way that it has an impact beyond just my life, but in the generations to come. I want to lean into something that's bigger than me. I'll be honest, I don't know that there's ever been a group of people on planet Earth that more embodied what William James said than the group of people in the opening pages of the book of Acts. You got your Bible? I want you to turn to Acts chapter 1. In just a moment, I'm going to read you some verses there, and we're going to unpack some truths. But before I do, let me kind of give you the backstory. What we're reading here in Acts chapter 1, he told you a moment ago, I'm the president of Send Network, and we always like to spell it S-E-N-D, because people hear it and they think I'm the president of Send Network, and I was president of that one for a long time too, but now it's Send Network because of Jesus. Amen? But we're a church planting network. We facilitate church planting. We love to work with churches and planting churches. What we're about to read is the story of the first ever church plant. I'm not talking about the first Baptist church or the first Methodist church. I'm talking about like the OG. This is the original church plant. And they had a launch grand opening Sunday in the city of Jerusalem about 2,000 years ago. And on Sunday number one, they preached the gospel. And Sunday number one, 3,000 people became followers of Jesus Christ. Now, I don't know how, Pastor Brett, I don't know how you measure church planting success here at Shadow Hills, but I would submit to you, if 3,000 people get saved on Sunday number one, that's a pretty good start. Amen? Like, I don't know about you, but I'd love to have been there. I'd like to be there on Sunday number one. We'd all get t-shirts printed up like I was there on the 3,000 day, right? If that's not enough, they came back on Sunday number two, the Bible tells us, a little later in the book of Acts. On Sunday number two, they preached the gospel again. On this day, so many people came to faith in Jesus, they couldn't count everybody, so they only counted the men, and there were over 5,000 men, which if you add women and children to that, we're now 2 weeks into a brand new church plant, somewhere between 15 and 20,000 new believers in Jesus Christ. Yeah, that's wow, right? Historians and scholars tell us that inside of 6 months, 100,000 people in Jerusalem became followers of Jesus Christ because of this new movement. You know one of the problems we have in the church in America today? We don't even think that kind of stuff is possible anymore. You said a moment ago, Pastor Rich, you're going to baptize at the end of the service today. You're baptizing at the other campus as well. You've been able to do that for the last... What if over the next 6 months we baptized 100,000 people? Let me ask you a question. Do you believe God can still do that? You do know that the same God that was sitting on the throne in Acts chapter 1 and Acts chapter 2 is still the same God sitting on the throne today, right? Like, he's never up for election. He doesn't take a day off. He doesn't go on vacation. God is still God, and God is still moving in the world. The problem is we just don't expect him to. History goes on and tells us that within 40 years of this moment that we're about to read about, the gospel reached every corner of the known world. What if God so began something here today? There are currently about 2 billion people on planet Earth who've never heard the name of Jesus and have no access to the gospel. Did you hear that? 2 billion people that have no access to the gospel. What if 40 years from today, because of what God began here today, we could say that every person on planet Earth has heard the name of Jesus? You're going to talk about impact. There are also roughly 2 billion people on planet Earth today who profess to be followers of Jesus Christ. Did you know that every one of us that profess to be followers of Jesus, you know where we trace our faith back? That this little handful of people in the book of Acts. That's where it all started. You and I are following literally in their footsteps. Which begs the question, if Jesus tarries and his coming is put off another 2,000 years, will there be millions of people around the world following in your footsteps and mine because of the way we're leveraging our faith? When I understood how much impact in the world this little group of people had, I did some research into this group of people. I wanted to know who they were. Like, I thought these must be like movers and shakers. These are world changers. These are like highly influential people. But when you understand who these people are, like, it's not a who's who list. As a matter of fact, if you were going to pick teams to change the world, nobody on this team would you have picked. J.D. Greer, my friend, says, never has a larger assignment been given to a less qualified group of people. They had no money. They had no education. They'd never led a ministry. They had no influence in society. They were not movers and shakers in the neighborhood. Literally a list of nobodies. And yet God used them to turn the world upside down. I don't know about you, but I find that very encouraging, because when I look at me, I feel like I'm kind of a nobody too. Like, I don't bring all this skill and acumen and experience to the table. I'm glad to know that God can take the nobodies of this world, because he's such a somebody through them, and turn the world upside down. But what was it that enabled them to be so mightily used of God? Well, there are a few things that I think we see in this text of Scripture that I want to pull out for us today, and I want to begin by reading it. Let's read in chapter 1 of Acts, verse 1. It says, in the first book, O Theophilus, I dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach, till the day when he was taken up, after he had given commands through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. He presented himself alive to them after his suffering, by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about, if you got your Bible open, what's the next phrase? Speaking about the what? The kingdom of God. That's an important phrase. We're going to come back to that. And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So, when they'd come together, they asked him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? Isn't it ironic that the early church made the same mistake we're making today? Jesus wanted to talk about his kingdom, and they want to talk about politics. Rome was in charge, and Israel was looking for a Messiah that was going to throw Rome out, put Israel back in charge so that they could run things again. Jesus wants to talk kingdom, and they said, hey, when are you going to put us back in charge? If we're not careful in the church in America, the undoing of the church in America is going to be the syncretism that exists between our political ideology and our understanding of faith. Both on the left and the right side of the aisle, we have taken what we believe about Christianity and so woven it with our political ideology that we don't know where one stops and the other starts. And a watching world is watching that. And we're doing exactly the same thing the early church wanted to do. You know what Jesus said to them when they started talking politics and he's wanting to talk kingdom movement? Here's what Jesus said. That's none of your business. You say you're making that up. No, let me read it to you. Look what he said. Lord, is now when you're going to restore the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it's not for you to know. Let me tell you what that means in the Greek. That's none of your business. It's not for you to know. Listen to what he says. This is important. Times or seasons that the Father is fixed by his own authority. We get all up in arms about government and politics and who's in charge. Here's what God said. Listen, I'm in control of all that. You know why those leaders are where they are? They're there because I put them there. And listen, when he said it, we're talking about a Roman government that was burning Christians at the stake. He said, that's not your business. Your business is not political upheaval. Your business is not social and cultural change. Jesus said, I've got something better for you than that. Everybody okay? All right, let's keep going. Verse 8. But you'll receive power. Don't worry about politics. You'll receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you'll be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And when he'd said these things as they were looking on, he was lifted up and a cloud took him out of their sight. While they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking in heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you watched him go into heaven. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. And when they entered the upper room, they went to the upper room where they were staying. Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus and Simon the Zealot and Judas the son of James, all these with one accord were devoting themselves to prayer, together with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. We'll stop reading there. We could read on, and honestly, if I'm being totally transparent, the verses that I've read, those 13 verses, we could spend the next 6 weeks just unpacking all the truth that is in those verses. But what I want to do in this morning, the time that I have, is I want to try to give you an overview of this text and show you four characteristics that I believe embodied this group of people that enabled them to so mightily be used of God to change the world. And here's what I love about these four characteristics. As you hear me unpack them, none of them are beyond our reach, meaning this, we can wrap our arms around these same things, and if we do it, I believe we're lifting up our sails so that should the wind of the Spirit of God choose to blow, we're ready to join in what he's doing. So here they are, number one. They had a faith that produced obedience. Let me say it another way. They trusted God and did what God said. Now, I know that sounds simple. But in the church age we're living in, makes sense, when it doesn't make sense. When it costs us, when it doesn't cost us. When it's comfortable, when it's uncomfortable. Whatever he says, that's what we're going to do. You say, where do you see that in the text? Well, the Bible says in verse 4 that he ordered them to go and wait in a city. What city did he tell them to go? If you were listening as I read, where did he tell them to go? Anybody know? Jerusalem, right? Now, you got to understand the context. To these people, Jerusalem was the scene of the crime. Like 40 days earlier, the streets of Jerusalem had been filled with people with violence and vulgarity pouring out of them, screaming to the top of their lungs about Jesus, "Crucify him." They had witnessed a horrific scene as Jesus was beaten, as he was dragged through a city, barely recognizable as a human being, as he was crucified and put to death on a cross. And then Jesus says, here's the plan. We're going to go start our church in Jerusalem. Made no sense. And yet the Bible says they went to Jerusalem. Why would they do that? There's only one explanation. It's what he said. It tells us some things about them. Number one, they didn't make their decisions based on their feelings. Jerusalem didn't feel good to anybody. Nobody had a warm fuzzy about going back to Jerusalem. Like you didn't need to do a demographic study of the neighborhood surrounding Jerusalem to find out if they were open to a new church or not. Like they had screamed in the streets, we don't want your Jesus. We don't want your church. We don't want your faith. We don't want your teaching. We don't want your lifestyle. We want nothing to do with you. It didn't feel good to go to Jerusalem. Matter of fact, it felt just the opposite. It felt like the wrong thing to do. They were terrified. They thought they were going to be killed. They didn't make their decisions based on their opinions. We're good about that in church, right? Let's get everybody's opinion. Let's take a poll. See what everybody thinks we ought to do. You know what happens when we do that, right? We miss God a lot of times. Because sometimes popular opinion is not what God wants us to do. Just ask Caleb and Joshua in the Old Testament. Matter of fact, if you hit in the early church in Acts chapter 1, if you'd passed out index cards to all the group, so here's what I'd like you to do. Write down the top three cities where you'd like us to go start our new church. Let me tell you what one city wasn't going to be on anybody's card. I'll take that back. Good old smart aleck Simon Peter. He'd have wrote it this way. I don't care where we go, as long as it's not Jerusalem. They didn't make their decision based on their circumstances. You ever heard this spiritual language Christians use? Well, I'm waiting for God to open a door or close a door. That sounds spiritual, right? Let me tell you what Jerusalem was. Closed door. Matter of fact, they literally nailed it shut. Here's what that tells us. They listened for what the Father said, and then they did what the Father said, whether it made sense to them or not. You know, one of the reasons we don't see God move in the church in America today in power, because we don't need to hear from God. We got our strategies and our budgets and our technology and our creativity and planning center. God help us all. Like, we don't need God. We know how to do church. We know how to gather a crowd. We know how to make people feel good. Or if we do step out in faith, it's like this. Well, we're not real sure what God wants us to do, so we're going to step out in, what do we call it? That's not faith. That's presumption on God, and that's a dangerous way to live your life and lead your family. The Bible says in Romans 10:17, faith comes by what? Say it out loud. Hearing. Faith comes by what? Hearing. Meaning until you hear from God, it ain't faith. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of who? Meaning, I got to hear his voice, and until I hear his voice, here's my responsibility. Go to Jerusalem and just wait. Wait on God to speak. When did the church lose its ability to just sit at the feet of the Father and wait on? God is not looking for us to come up with a plan. He can bless. God has a plan. He's waiting on us to wait on him to speak and join in what he's doing. The early church had a faith that produced obedience. Number two, let's move on. They had a passion that produced unity. He joked a moment ago about your church partnering with the Baptist Convention. I'm going to prove to you that the first church here in Jerusalem is not a Baptist church. Now, you got to understand in saying that, I've been a Baptist longer than I've been a Christian, so I'm picking on myself here. And I'm going to prove to you this ain't a Baptist church. Look at verse 13. I'm sorry, verse 14, first phrase. All these with one accord. Now, that's not describing them all driving around Jerusalem in a Honda. That's not what that is. This one accord is a Greek phrase that means one mind, one heart, one passion, meaning the whole church had all wrapped its heart around one priority. Living proof. That ain't no Baptist church. Pastor, you telling me we don't have passion? No. We got passion. Here's the problem. We all got passion about something different. One person passionate about this particular ministry. One person passionate about this particular cultural problem. One person passionate about this particular demographic. And because we all got different passions, rather than uniting us for the cause of Christ and the kingdom, it divides us, and the church is seen by the world not as a united mission, but as a divided family that's broken and splintered. But not the early church. Well, what is it that they wrap their heart around? Well, most Christians immediately think it's verse 8, because we think the first seven verses of Acts chapter 1 are just in their introduction to get us to verse 8. But the real key is in verse 3. Look at verse 3. He presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about, say it out loud again, the what? The kingdom of God. Now, just quickly, let me give you the context here. 40 days after Jesus died and was resurrected before he ascended back to heaven. So it's Jesus' last 40 days physically on planet Earth that Luke is describing here in Acts. And Luke says for 40 days, every time Jesus appeared to his disciples, he preached the same sermon. He only spoke about one thing. You imagine if for the next 40 weeks, Pastor Brett shows up and preaches the same sermon every Sunday for 40 weeks. I know what's going to happen. Y'all going to do some index cards, right, and get some opinions out there. Jesus shows up for 40 days. Over and over. Kingdom, 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 kingdom. It's almost as if he said, if you forget everything else I taught you in 3.5 years of public ministry, don't forget this. Kingdom of God. Shouldn't surprise us. In the greatest sermon he ever preached, right in the middle of it, he said, seek first the what? The kingdom. And listen, if you understand the Greek context there, the Greek seek first is not a suggestion Jesus is laying on the table for us to prayerfully consider putting in our top 10 list. It's an imperative, which means Jesus, by way of command, says everything in your life should revolve around and be funneling towards the kingdom of God. And you look at the church in America today, we talk about the church like it's the end-all, be-all. Listen, did you know that the church is not the goal? Can I give you some bad news this morning? One day Shadow Hills Church is going to die. You know how I know that? All churches do. If you don't believe me, go find any church that got a book deal in the New Testament. Ephesus, Colossae, Corinth, gone. I've stood in the remains of the church at Corinth and the church at Ephesus. In their heyday, thriving epicenters of gospel kingdom activity, you know what they are today? Pile of rocks in the Middle East. Dead and gone. Listen, churches are temporary, but hear me. The kingdom of God's alive and well. What is the kingdom? Here's the kingdom. The kingdom, here's the definition. It's God's sovereign activity in the world resulting in people being in right relationship with himself. It's the big picture of what God is doing globally. And you do understand that while we sit here today, God is on a mission in this world, redeeming a people to himself from every tribe, every tongue, every people, and every nation. And one day, somewhere in some part of the world, the last soul is going to be ushered into the kingdom, and King Jesus is going to come again, and we'll rule and reign with him for eternity in the kingdom of God. There won't be Baptists and Methodists and Presbyterians. It's going to be the kingdom of God. And guess what? Right now, we're living in the greatest days in the history of Christianity to be alive. Did you know that there are more people coming to faith in Jesus today on a daily basis around the world than at any other single time in human history? You didn't hear what I just said, or you'd have said something, so I'm going to give you another shot at it. There are more people coming to faith in Jesus today on a daily basis around the world than at any other single time in the history of the world. And get this, God birthed your church not just so you could have cool worship services on the weekend. God birthed your church to lift up your eyes and look on the fields and join in his activity of his kingdom being expanded to the ends of the earth. And the early church, they so wrapped their hearts around it. They said, we don't care what color the carpet is. We don't care if the music's loud or soft. We don't care if the preacher's long or short. We don't care if you wear shorts and flip-flops or suit and ties. We're going to be about the kingdom of God expanded in cities and nations all over the world. Number three, we could spend some more time there, but let's move on. They had a desperation that produced prayer. How many of you believe God has a sense of humor? Let me see your hand. If you don't believe that, repent, raise your hand now, because he does. Where do you think we got ours from? We're made in his image. Did you know that there's funny verses in the Bible? Some of the funniest I read for you a moment ago, and you've read it so many times, you didn't even get the joke. I'm going to read it for you again to give you another shot. Look at it. Acts chapter 1, verse 9. And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. See, you've read it so much, you missed the joke. That's hilarious. You say, what's hilarious? Here's what it said. And when he had said these things, what had he said? Well, here's what he just said. Okay, everybody lean in. Here's the plan. Now, I want you to participate with me this morning like we're on the hill with him. Jesus said, lean in. Here's the plan. So lean in a little bit. Lean in, look at me, all right? Here's the plan. Here's what's going to happen. We're going to start our movement. Here's what we're going to do. I want you to first go to Jerusalem where they hate you. Lean in. Then we're going to go to Judea and Samaria where you hate them. You see, the Jews hated the Samaritans, called them dogs. So here's the plan. Lean in. You're going to go where they hate you and want to kill you. Then you're going to go where you hate them, Judea and Samaria. Then you're going to go to the remotest part of the earth. What's that? Places in the world that they didn't know existed and didn't know how to get there. So here's the plan. Lean in. Go where they hate you and want to kill you. Then go where you hate them. And then go where you don't know exists and you don't know how to get there. And then he starts floating. And I'm not talking like Las Vegas levitation act. I mean, gone. Did somebody write down what he just... And I believe they all just stood there. I'm not making it up. Look at the next verse. Verse 10. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, what's that look like? And I believe if what hadn't happened next hadn't happened, you'd have found 120 dead people with their jaws wide open on that hillside. They'd have died right there in that spot. But you know what happened next? Jesus gets up to heaven, looks down, sees them all standing there looking up into heaven, sends two angels down there to tell them to move along. You say, you're making that up. No, I'm not. Look. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, get this, men of Galilee, what are you doing standing here looking up into heaven? And everything changed with the next phrase. Here's what they said. This Jesus have watched go up into heaven. Here it is. Will come in the same way you watched him go. Here's what they said. Hey, get on about the mission because he's coming back. And as soon as they heard it, they ran down off of that hill. They boldly ran back into Jerusalem where they were hated. They ran up into that upper room. They slammed the door and they pulled out a whiteboard and began to do demographic research into how they could build relational bridges into their community, meet the felt needs so that they could. Isn't that what they did? No, what does it say they did? The text says they devoted themselves to pray. Listen, they didn't pray to start the meeting. Prayer was the meeting. And this was no, let's take 45 minutes of prayer requests and pray for 3 seconds on the way out the door. These were people so desperate. Because if God didn't show up and do what God said he was going to do, they knew they were sunk. There's another reason why we're not seeing God move in the church in America today. We don't pray together anymore. You know what we've done in the church in America? We've relegated corporate prayer to moments of transition when we move the band on and off the stage. We don't stop to pray. We just pray to move stuff around while nobody's looking. Don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying it's wrong to move stuff around while nobody's looking. I'm saying it's just wrong to pray just to move stuff around. 26 times in the 28 chapters of the book of Acts after this moment, you find the church praying together. We talk about prayer like it's this private, get in your closet, do this by yourself. Listen, we need to pray privately, but there's something that happens when we pray together that transcends our praying privately. Most of the big moments in the book of Acts didn't happen when somebody preached. They happened when the church prayed. We've lost our sense of desperation. I got so convicted about this over at Hope Church in 2015 that we decided to carve out 8 to 10 minutes in every weekend worship service, and they still do it now. We lead the whole church. We take a verse of scripture, and we lead the whole church to pray corporately for 10 minutes every weekend. And when we started it, some people pushed back and said, you can't do that. I mean, 4,000 people coming together. What about all the lost people, all the unchurched people that come? Let me tell you what I discovered. Honest truth. When lost people come to a church, they actually expect us to talk to God. Not only that, they came to church hoping we would show them how they could talk to God. And let me tell you what we've learned. When you seek God in prayer, you experience God in power. And when you don't, you don't. What if we got desperate for God again and began to pray? I'll tell you a quick story before I finish. When I got to Las Vegas 22 years ago, my family, my wife's over here and one of our daughters is here. We moved here 22 years ago to plant Hope Church. We got here, didn't know anybody. I'm from Alabama originally. I mean, if you're from Alabama, you don't go to Las Vegas. If you do, you don't tell anybody, right? Like, that's where I'm from. They didn't think Las Vegas was hell, but they thought you could smell it from here. Like, it's close. Like, it's, I didn't know. We get here and don't know a soul. My first week, we get a phone call from a Filipino lady named Letty Peralta. Letty says, Pastor, can I tell you a story? I said, Letty, I don't know anybody in Las Vegas. You can tell me any story you want to tell me. She said, Pastor, I'm from the Philippines. I moved to Hong Kong to make money for my family that was very poor. She said, while living in Hong Kong, I moved in with an American family, became a part of their family, so much so that when that family moved back to America, I moved with them. She said, we settled in a suburb north of Atlanta, Georgia, called Woodstock, Georgia. She said, I heard a preacher there and got a part of that church and heard the gospel and the kingdom of God like I'd never heard it before, and it changed my life. But I only got to go there about 6 or 7 times, and then my family relocated to Las Vegas, Nevada. She said, we lived in Las Vegas for 1.5 years, and here's what she said on the phone. Pastor, I've prayed every day for 1.5 years that the First Baptist Church of Woodstock, Georgia would start a church in Las Vegas, Nevada. Would you please tell me who sent you here? 2 weeks earlier, my family loaded everything we owned in a green Dodge minivan in the parking lot of the First Baptist Church of Woodstock, Georgia. having been sent to Las Vegas, Nevada to start a church, and none of us even knew Letty Peralta existed. For 22 years, we've seen God do unbelievable things. Over 5,000 people have come to faith in Christ, been baptized into that fellowship. It's a church that this morning will have 54 first languages spoken in their fellowship. It looks like what heaven's going to look like. It's a church that's been a part of joining in planting 80 churches in the western United States. And I get a call once a month from some church planter somewhere in the world. And they say, man, how does a white dude from Alabama come to Vegas, a place like that, see a multi-ethnic church that's planting churches? How does it happen? Listen, I'm not trying to be super spiritual. I'm not trying to be humble. I'm just trying to be honest. Here's the truth. One lady from the Philippines. She so grabbed a hold of the altar of God and didn't let go. That for 22 years, we rode a wave of the favor of God's activity because she was desperate. Here's my question today. Who's going to be Letty here? Who is Shadow Hills that's going to grab a hold of the altar of God and not let go? Until you see the wind of the Spirit of God blow. And the only explanation is not our facility, it's not our programming, it's not our music, it's not our preaching, it's not our hospitality, it's not the gifts we give away, it's not our processes, it's not our strategy. The only explanation is God did. What only God could do. And to God be the glory. Here's the last thing, I'm done. They had the Spirit that produced power. There's a lot that happened in Acts chapter 2 that I can't explain. I'm just being honest. There's a lot of division about what happened in Acts chapter 2. And we're going to get to heaven. Somebody's going to be wrong. Might be us. Here's what I do know. On that day, the church was empowered by the Holy Spirit like never before. And here's what we need today. We need a fresh outpouring of the Holy Spirit of God. But it's not going to happen until we have a faith that produces obedience. Until we have a passion that unites us together. And until we have a desperation that drives us to our face, crying out to a holy God to do what we cannot do apart from Him. Then and only then will we see the Holy Spirit move in power. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, as only you can, would you take these truths right now and bring conviction into our hearts and lives. In just a moment, the band's going to come and lead us in a time of worship. I'm going to go ahead and invite our prayer partners to come and join me here all along the front. Maybe you're here today and you don't know this Jesus that I've been talking about. Listen, the whole reason I've been talking to this church today about mission is because this church exists to introduce people just like you to Jesus. Jesus loves you. Jesus wants to be known by you, and He wants to know you. If you don't know Jesus today, when this team begins to sing in a moment, when we stand, you can come to one of these prayer partners today and simply say, I need Jesus. And they'll have somebody show you from a Bible how you can begin a relationship with God. Maybe you're here and you just want to come pray with one of these prayer partners about something that God's convicted you about today. Maybe there's an area of obedience that you hadn't been willing to say yes to. Or maybe we'll just take these steps and open them up like an old-fashioned altar. Maybe you want to just get with some people that you're in small group with or people that you do ministry with and just come huddle here at this altar and just begin to cry out to God. God, would you move? Lord, would you pour out your Spirit? God, would you bless? Holy Spirit of God, in this moment, have